Today I'm going to take you through how I plan my Milky Way photography shoots. When it comes to shooting the stars, you could just drive to try and find a good location, you could go into your backyard, but the best way is to plan your shoot so you get the best out of your time underneath the stars. Now, there are techniques you need to know to shoot the stars well and to get a nice shot of the Milky Way. But once you know these, the most important thing is to find a good location. So this all comes down to planning. I use lightpollutionmaps.info in conjunction with Google Maps to do this. And also I use Photopills, which is a paid app, and a few other free apps. These are Plume for air quality and Clear Outside for a good forecast of the clouds for that night. To start with, you need to find a location that doesn't have too much light pollution. I search for places that have a Bortel level 3 or lower. If you don't know what the Bortel scale is, click on the eye in the corner or the link in the description for another of my tutorials. The Bortel scale is basically a scale of light pollution, 9 being bad, 1 being good, and then all of the levels in between. On lightpollutionmaps.info, it gives you different colors for different ratings, and you can see the map underneath these colors to work out where the good places are. If I look on the map now, I live in Bangkok at the moment, and as you can see, it's just a bright blob, and most big cities are. So if I click around about where I live, what Light Pollution Map will do is bring up this little table of the info for that location. So from this, there is a lot of information there. All you need to concentrate on is the Bortel scale. And here it says class 8 to 9. So that's why in this big city, you don't see many stars at all in the sky. So I need to get to somewhere that's a lot darker, so I do get to see all of those stars and potentially I get to see the Milky Way as well. If I was to take a photograph here, it wouldn't look brilliant and I'd probably see a handful of stars, 5, maybe 10 stars at most. At a quick glance, Cambodia looks great for night skies, but with the borders still being closed at the moment, there's no chance of me traveling to a different country. So keeping within Thailand, there's this patch over to the west. I can see the border coming down here, and there is this patch here, which is a lot darker than where I am now. This is northwest of Kanchanaburi, so I'll zoom in. And I can see the map underneath. I can see this lake here. So if I click on parts of this map, you can see this is a class 1 level. So the night skies are really dark in this location. So in this area where there are those class 1 Bortel skies, there's not much infrastructure. And also I can see that Bangkok is probably around about 200 kilometers away from this area. Now, even though that's quite far, the city is very bright. And if there's any kind of haze in the air, that brightness will catch that haze, and on the horizon you'll normally see a glow from big cities like this. There is a road with a few viewpoints along it overlooking a lake, but most of the views are looking west. You will see why this is important a bit later on in the video, so make sure to keep watching to find out why direction is so important. So I'll keep searching. I'm going to zoom out and then I'll have a look at a few other locations. If I look to the north towards Chiang Mai, that's all quite bright, but it is surrounded by darker areas. But I actually want to go south. Now I've zoomed in on the area of the Thai Islands. I've got Phuket, I've got Krabi, I've got Koh Lanta, and I've got a lot more islands in there. Even though it does look quite busy, I think there are a few locations in this area that could have a potential to be able to get good night skies. Now the island of Phuket is pretty much lit up like a Christmas tree on this. And if I click on it, it's anywhere between a class 6 and a class 4. So there is a lot of light pollution on Phuket. Now, if I come a bit further south, there is this island here. So if I zoom in on that one, and that's Koh Lanta. Now, northwest of the island, there's a Bortel 4 level, but right down at the south end of the island, it drops to level 2 on the Bortel scale. So you can see knowing the Bortel level is really important. I know by looking at this map which areas are going to be really good and which areas are going to be really bad. Now on to the reason why direction is so important. If you've found a potential location near you, you need to find out where the Milky Way is going to be in the sky, where it will rise and where it will set. And if there's a big city in that direction you plan on shooting, Even though it might be 50 to 100 kilometers away and the Bortle rating is good where you are, it may affect your images by putting a glow on the horizon, and if there's haze in the air, it can actually bounce off that haze. Now, I use the app Photopills to work out where the Milky Way is going to rise and where it's going to set, so I know which direction I'm going to be shooting in. If you don't know about Photopills, I did a video on it a few years ago. It's a fantastic photography planning app that's well worth getting. It is a paid app, but I think it's $9.99 at the moment, so not much at all really. So if I go into the app and then I'll scroll down to Night AR, what this will do is we'll put where the Milky Way and where other celestial objects are going to be in the sky over what the camera sees. In the settings in the top right hand corner, I'll put in the dates I could potentially travel there and also the location. Koh Lanta, dates, let's go April the 12th, and time. And I'm going to set the time to just before midnight. So 23:57. Okay. Now you might be wondering why I put those specific dates in, and this will link in with one of the steps a bit later on in the video. So if I hold the phone up and look around, I can see which direction the Milky Way core is going to rise in. And at this location, on the 12th of April, I know that it's going to rise in the southeast, and the Milky Way will be quite flat in the sky. But then if I move the time on, so if I come to around about 4 a.m. in the morning, I can see that in the south, the core is going to be really high in the sky, and also that Milky Way is going to be a lot more vertical. So I've got a few different options to shoot in this location. If I go earlier in the night, the Milky Way will be quite flat in the sky. And if I go later on towards the end of nighttime, the Milky Way is going to be a lot more vertical. So I need to check my locations, and I need to check the directions in the south and the southeast. So if I go back into light pollution map, I can see to the southeast of Koh Lanta, there is a dark patch of sky. So towards there, so looking towards Koh Lebong and Koh Muk. Now these cities over to the east, they may cause a bit of a problem, but I'm probably going to chance it. I think it's going to be okay, even if I have to wait till later on in the night until the Milky Way has come further towards the south. I might have to wait until then, but I'm going to chance it. I'll probably stay out all night. These cities are about 40 to 50 kilometers away, but they do have the potential to bleach out that part of the sky. So another thing I need to check is what is to the south of Koh Lanta. So if I zoom out a little bit, now there are all of these little islands, they might cause a problem. And then to the south-southeast, we've got Langkawi. This is around about 120 to 130 kilometers away, so hopefully that won't cause too much of a problem. So when looking for a potential location, you need to get a good Bortle rating, the lower the better, and then you need to make sure the sky is dark in the direction you'll be shooting. Next, I'll have a look to see what there is in terms of infrastructure to get to those places that I'm thinking about. And for this, I'll switch back and forth from light pollution maps to Google Maps. I mentioned Phuket earlier. Now that has a really good infrastructure, but a fair bit of light pollution. Now Koh Lanta has less of a road system to get to those places I'm thinking of. So I'll get Koh Lanta in the middle and I'll zoom in on the map. So you can see the main road comes down, goes over a bridge, comes down here and down to Koh Lanta Old Town. Also, I don't want to run into any wild dogs in the middle of the night, in the middle of nowhere. In this part of the world, that is something I've got to think about. There are wild dogs, and also there are quite a lot of guard dogs around people's properties. So that is something that you do need to think about if you are traveling to different locations. What are the potential hazards? And what might be there to stop you being able to take the photograph? Now I'm going to zoom into the area I'm thinking of going to, which is right down on the southern tip. What I'll also do is switch it to the satellite mode to see if there are any potential beaches or anything like that. And then I'll use the little man to see what the road conditions are like. I can see that there's a road going right down to this southern tip. So I'll grab that little dude and then I'll drop him onto the road. So you can see it's a paved road, so there shouldn't be too much of a problem. There's also a resort on Bamboo Beach just to the northwest, so that's a potential for somewhere to stay nearby. Obviously, I don't live down there, so this is important, and we'll probably be sleeping there in the day to recover if we do get a full night shoot in. If you were just driving to a location, you wouldn't have to necessarily do this, But if that is the case, you do need to get some sleep, and you don't want to be driving hours and hours, shooting all through the night and then driving back without any sleep. So make sure you do go down with friends if you are doing this to share the drive, because the little amounts of sleep that you will be getting will have an effect on how good your driving will be. So if I look at Bamboo Beach, I'll just click on that now, and then I'll click on a few of these photos. There is the potential on this beach to wait for the Milky Way to come above this headland, and then have the headland, the beach in the front, the sea down one side, and the Milky Way coming over that. Now, around about 1.5 kilometers away is Waterfall Bay. It does say that there's a lighthouse there, but that could actually make a good subject. As long as it's not too bright, and as long as I can actually get to that location at night, that could be a really good potential. There's also a beach on either side as well, so I've got a few different options and a few different shooting positions. Now, I don't know if I can get to this location at night, and the only way to see is to really try when we get down there. Another thing I like to do is have a backup plan just in case I can't make it to that main location. So the first backup is Bamboo Beach, where I'd have that headland and the Milky Way rising above it. Now, the second option is on the east of the island. So if I go back into light pollution map to the east of the island, there's a point just south of Ban Lo Yai. So if I zoom in on the island, there's this point here, and that again is a class 2 Bortal location. Now I need to see how that looks when I get there. Again, once I'm on the island, I'll do a bit of scouting in the day to be familiar with the location and any problems that might arise to stop me from getting there and to make it a little bit hazardous once I'm there. If I know everything that's going on in that location, I know what the problems might be. And this is really important. If you just pick a place and go there, you might get lucky, and most of the time you probably will be all right. But you might run into problems from locked gates and poor access to roads being closed or blocked. And in some cases, a few different hazards. Now, I've been to a few locations where we've been to that location, I didn't scope it out, and we went to open the door and there was a pack of wild dogs in that area. Their heckles came up, so I very much closed the door because they were big dogs and they weren't happy. So we closed the door and we carried on driving. So if there are potential for any big animals that could do you harm, or any packs of animals that could do you harm, you do really need to be aware of this as well. If I'm just driving to a location, I'll tend to go there in the day to check it out and then hang around at a local restaurant or cafe until it gets dark and then head back to the location I've chosen. But a scout beforehand can give you a lot of valuable information. So back on Google Maps, and time to find that headland to the south of Ban Lo Yai. As you can see, there is a road that runs down here. I'll grab my little man again and drop him on the road. It's always a good sign when you've seen that the Google car has been down a certain road. So normally you can tell that the access is pretty good. Now that does look like a dirt track, but again, it looks okay. Now the other good thing with Google Maps is that you can see where others might have taken photos and plotted them on the map. I can see that already at that endpoint it says best sunset view. So if I click on that, and then I click on the images that have been saved at that location, you can see there's this old pier. So that could make an interesting foreground element. Also, I've got the islands in the background, so there is a potential for a shot there. And that does look like it's shot south, so that might work later on in the night. One other thing to look for on Google Maps is the streetlights. I can see here that there are no streetlights running down this road, and streetlights are one thing that can throw a lot of light into your shot. And sometimes it can ruin your shot as well. So that's another thing to check for. There's no streetlights here, so we should be okay. I'll just come out of that, and then I'll look for a few other locations. Straight away, I can see two different camera icons. I'll click on this bottom one, which has a Thai name, and I can't read Thai, so I'm not sure what that means, but it looks like it's a concrete pier. So that could be a potential for a leading line into the shot. And that looks like it's almost pointing southeast. It's probably more east than southeast, but I could go out onto this and shoot from the pier southwards, or I could shoot along the pier. Now, one thing I've noticed straight away is there are street lights on this pier. So that's one thing I have to be very wary about. They'll chuck so much light into that foreground that they could potentially ruin it. So if we come back out of that, I'll click on this other viewpoint as well. Now this one actually looks better than that last one because there are no streetlights on this. It just depends what's behind it. And just so happens that someone's taken a photo pointing the other way. So this one does actually look a little bit better. There are no street lamps along this, and it doesn't look like there's any street lamps on the road behind there as well. So this is another location. So you can see with a little bit of planning, it is pretty straightforward to find locations that you might be able to drive to fly to, or to take a long holiday to potentially get some great photos of the night skies. After doing all of that, it's time to find out what the moon is doing to get some dates to go out. When there is a full moon, you might be able to see what's going on at night on the ground, but the moon does bleach out a lot of the stars. And especially when there's a bit of haze in the sky, this really accentuates that bleaching, and sometimes it can make the Milky Way completely invisible. So I'll just go into Photopills, and then I'll click on the Moon tab. You'll get loads of information in this one, from where the sun sets to where the Milky Way core will potentially become visible in the night, and at what orientation it'll be in the sky. So whether it's quite flat in the sky or whether it's more vertical in the sky. As the full moon dates are around about the same wherever you are on our planet, unless I'm traveling really far, I'll just tap on the right arrowhead until I get to the new moon. If I'm traveling far, I'll click on settings and put in my location. But I don't worry too much about this as the times will be about the same. So if I press on that right arrow, I do have a full moon in a couple of days' time, but I don't have enough time to get down to the islands. So I'll keep tapping through. So the full moon will be on the 29th of March in 2021. So about 14 days after this, there should be a new moon. So I'll just go on from that. And there we go. The 12th of April is when there's a new moon. I'll normally shoot either on the day of the new moon, or if work gets in the way, I'll plan around it. I will go up to 4 to 5 days either side of a new moon, but I'll just make sure the moon isn't in the sky too much when the Milky Way is in the sky. For instance, if I go to the 7th of April in the Moon tab, so I'll just go 5 days before, the moon sets at 3 p.m. and doesn't rise until 3:44 a.m. the following day. At 11:20, the Milky Way would start to rise, and I'd be able to see this right through until the moon rises at 3:44 a.m. And with the moon at 19%, if the air quality is good, I could potentially use the moonlight to light the land. But that's kind of getting into advanced astrophotography shooting. Now, if I go to the 17th of April, which is 5 days after the new moon, the moon rises at 9:53 in the morning. It's at 23%, so about quarter brightness, and it sets at 10:45 p.m. So I won't get the start of the Milky Way rising at 10:40, but as the moon sets, the Milky Way will become into view, and it will get brighter the further the moon is below the horizon. Now you could probably shoot for more days either side of the new moon than this, but you just need to keep an eye on when the moon rises and sets and when the Milky Way rises and sets. As long as there is time where the Milky Way is still visible in the sky after the moon has set or before it has risen, then you'll have a chance of getting a photo of the Milky Way. The last thing to do is to keep an eye on the weather for clear skies and the air quality for haze, pollution and visibility. You want the skies to be as clear as possible and to be as haze-free as possible as well. I'll normally use the local weather forecast on TV and online to keep an eye on the forecast. And as I get closer to the days we're meant to be out shooting, I'll start to look at clear outside for the cloud coverage and then plume for the air quality. So those are those two apps I mentioned earlier. So sometime after the middle of April, if I'm successful, I'm going to take you on a shoot with me by filming the experience. And if it's not too successful either, I might just make a video on that as well, so you can kind of have a laugh at my expense and you can see what happens when a shoot goes wrong. So fingers crossed for some clear skies and good locations for those dates we're heading down to the islands. Now, how do you plan your astrophotography shoots? Do you do anything differently, or do you follow a similar pattern? Or is this your first time? Are you planning a shoot or planning a location? Let me know in the comments below. It'll be great to hear your thoughts. And if you like this video, click here next. Or if you want to binge watch a load of astrophotography tutorials, click down here. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe for weekly tutorials in photography. I'll see you next time.